Hey folks, welcome back to Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Dan Meyer.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart-Johnson.
And today we're talking about being wrong in math class, how that feels, what we can do about it. It feels like math class has the most sharply defined sense of right and wrong, correct and incorrect, of any class that we teach. And students respond to that sense and are eager to find out, am I right, am I wrong? They are fed that sense by us, our curriculum, grading practices, all of that. And I'm here wondering with Bethany, is there a different, a better way to treat wrongness and rightness in math class? You taught primary, I taught secondary. I only taught math, and you taught multiple subjects. I'm just curious, how was rightness and wrongness handled in other subjects besides math? And are there lessons that we could learn as math teachers from that?
You know, I think it kind of ties in with the culture that we're trying to create in our classroom. I want a culture where there isn't this level of fear and anxiety about making errors. I want my students to see themselves as risk takers, and that the classroom space is an area where they can and should take risks. And that's how we're learning, and that's how we're growing. And I try to be really transparent if I've made an error and kind of talking through how I'm going to problem solve that. And I want my students to be able to do that too. And I think oftentimes in, let's say, reading, for example, or in writing, we would never, I think, shame a student for mispronouncing a word. I hope not. Or for needing more support to navigate a tricky passage or unpack complex text. And yet in math, I feel like there can be this real anxiety of, one, if I'm not fast in getting my answer quickly, and two, if I'm incorrect. It's like, no, that's wrong. You know, instead of really diving into the thought process behind it and what's happening.
I think part of the disadvantage teachers have that, like, parents don't, for instance, is a set of very sharply defined and numerous objectives for student learning. Like, the teacher feels like a certain level of anxiety. Like, I am expected to make you learn a thing. I have a couple of moves in my pocket for how to turn wrong answers from an item of anxiety for the teacher, shame for the student, into like a moment of learning and honoring the sincere knowledge students are bringing to the task. I'll share one of them. Yeah. And I'm hoping that our audience, which you and I would agree is, I'm sure, the most intelligent, best looking audience in the podcast game, the video series game. Check it out. Okay, so this is the curriculum that Desmos is building. We're collaborating with Amplify also on a curriculum that offers, I think, students opportunities to be right and wrong in different interesting ways. That's one of Desmos's 5 design principles, because wrongness can be brilliant and interesting. Here's the game. You want to move that bumper over to hit that star. Just give me any kind of number you want to try it out here.
Well, I think as a student, I might just look at the target and I might say 8, because that's the destination.
Great. And as we talked about in our technology episode, everyone's favorite, obviously, you all watched that one, if not, check it out, is that we try to give students interpretive feedback. We didn't just say, not 8's wrong, but like, hey, here's what 8 means in the context, in this context right here. 8 moved over 8. And so what do you imagine a student's next move might be here, Bethany?
I would think then they would maybe look at, oh, wait, I'm not attending to where the bumper is starting, which is the -5. So I need it to even get to 0 before I can get to the 8. So then they might say 13.
So 13, we try it out. It goes. Okay. So here's, you got it here. And so here's step number 1 for us, for me, is like asking questions that don't have a right or wrong answer is a very fantastic way to get out of the anxiety that comes with wrong answers. So describe your strategy, for instance, versus like, what is the number? The student answers here, like I would struggle to call any of them right, and I would struggle to call any of them wrong. They are a mix of, you know, completion and incompletion, the student's honest thinking at that moment, and ideally it gives us it points towards what students are learning and what they might learn. And then there are questions that actually do have a right or wrong answer. So like, here is a situation. If one were to set up an equation to find the answer for this problem, to make the bumper hit that star, what do you imagine students do here? What are your thoughts?
First, I want to say that the star, the action, getting the star was very satisfying. And I'm appreciating that there are so many different things that I can attend to when I'm looking at. And so I'm looking now, I'm noticing where the arrow is going, and I'm trying to figure out, okay, how am I going to get it to move in the negative direction? Let's see. So my first response would be 3/4 plus X equals 1/8, because like with the other problem, I want it to get to 1/8. So that would be, it looks like that's the second equation. That's the second option.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But then I just saw it said select all the equations, which makes me, then I'm like, oh, but there's more, which is a whole interesting conversation in itself. So
yeah, what that hint stores. Yeah, for sure.
So I think, you know, a very tempting answer, and one I'm tempted to say, but then I had to kind of like think about it a little more, is that last one, 3/4 minus 1/8 equals X, because I want to find out that distance, the difference between those two.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. then I thought about that a little bit more, and I said, but which direction would that actually move the bumper? So then it made me go to the third one, which is 1/8 minus 3/4 equals X. But I can see myself initially choosing the 3/4 minus 1/8 equals X.
Ooh, and isn't that a beautiful thing right there? I can see myself thinking how a student would think.
Yeah.
And for a teacher to have that impulse, I mean, that's beautiful right there. Yeah. Like, you know, we've talked in the past about like how teachers and students often, there's a certain alienation across, you know, age, you know, whatever, like we're just different. And knowledge especially. But you're able to say like, I can see how someone who is smart would think that. And that to me is such a core attribute of a teacher right there. And so it turns out this is how a lot of students think about it. I'll just tell you this right here, that this is the most common answer. I love that I can dip into our curriculum and just grab a bunch of student thinking, you know, 1,000 students, and see what they did here, anonymize it, and just learn from it. So it turns out that 47% of students chose these, the correct answers. But 9% of students, a non-trivial number, choose this one right here, the wrong answer. They pull this one in, which is wrong because it produces a positive number, and we're going in the negative direction for one reason that it's wrong. And so one thing I might do here as a teacher is say, I feel anxious, what do I do with this? One thing you can do here that I just love to do is to say to students, folks, I'm seeing so much of this right here. Lots of folks are picking this one. It's a very tempting answer to pick. It is wrong. What I'm curious about is, in what world would it be right?
I just love the reframing. What a cool invitation. Not only saying, you know, let's highlight the one that everyone's picking that isn't correct, but let's highlight it and why isn't it correct? But what would it actually look like if it was correct? And that, just that little tweak, actually just makes it so much richer. I love that.
We would love to hear what you folks do with wrong answers to help students feel like they are wrong and brilliant.
You can either reach us on Twitter at MTL Show, or you can find us on Facebook, Math Teacher Lounge. In fact, we have a whole Facebook group, Math Teacher Lounge, and it's actually like hanging out in the teacher lounge with us. You can see additional footage that we weren't able to include in the episodes. You can also just continue conversations with other educators. You can also email us, mathteacherlounge@gmail.com. And like Dan was saying, we want to hear, what does this look like in your classroom? How are you creating a culture where students are able to take risks and have conversations about potential mistakes or wrong answers? So we may feature your ideas on a future segment. We can't wait. Thanks so much for joining us. Bye.